Channel of Love, a story of healing through divine love, a love that never fails and never dies. Written by Susan Carroll. Narrated by Leah Frederick. To my spirit, who has waited patiently and lovingly all these years for our voice to be heard, for our story to be told. Preface. This story is the record of my encounter with divine love. It took place at a time in my life when nothing else but the love of God could see me through the darkness of alcoholism and depression. I always knew that, one day, I would write and publish this book, but it took 9 years for me to find the courage to do so. I knew God wanted me to speak my truth and tell the story of my miraculous redemption and transformation. I understand that, for many readers, it will be an unbelievable story, one that simply could not have taken place and was therefore contrived and created in an unstable mind and spirit. For how can there be such a direct communion with God, guides, and departed loved ones? I know what I have experienced, and have recorded the events from memory and journals to the best of my ability. During the writing process, I also allowed my spirit to come forward and bring inspiration to the writing process, helping to choose words or remember important pieces of the story that I may have forgotten or failed to record. At times, my heart felt as if my spirit was telling the story and I was merely the scribe. What joyful writing that was! In present time, I still receive written messages of love and support from my guides in heaven who love and watch over me. But I have no direct communication with God, Mother God, Irab, or my mother. I know in my heart that they are continuing to send their love, support, and guidance, but in a different way now. When I pray for guidance or just sit quietly and listen with my heart, I hear the same message. Go with love. Always choose love. The completion of this book is an assignment long overdue, but it's never too late to speak the truth. As my spirit told me many years ago, you will tell the story and the truth shall set you free. I am now indeed free. Thank you to all who have loved me, guided me, inspired me to tell this story of never-ending love that has no boundaries and no end. Love never fails. Love wins. Susan Carroll, March 9, 2020. Chapter 1, The Beginning. When we least expect it, a shift happens. We often do not see or feel it coming, but it is there, silently waiting to be recognized as the hand of God beginning to move in our lives. Once in this place, this force is so powerful that it can rearrange an entire life in an instant and remain in place forever. Before the shift, my life, spanning 5 decades, was just a story. When I was a child, I felt as if the story was being written for me by some invisible, all-powerful force that was responsible for writing all children's life stories. I saw that some children had better stories than others, stories that were full of love and joy and secure in ways that I could only witness but never experience. In my innocent mind, I did not understand why I was given this story, but I intuitively knew that it was mine, my part to play as best I could. The seeds of insecurity, fear, anxiety, and the longing for unconditional love were all planted during this time and flourished well during my teenage and adult years. My mother and father, as all parents do, did the best they knew how to create a safe and loving home for their children. In some ways, they were successful, but in other ways, they were not. Working as a physician, my father was able to provide a financially stable home, but together, they struggled to create a home that was emotionally stable and secure for their four children. My earliest memories of my life with my parents, my brothers, and my sister are filled with both great joy and great pain. Love and joy could be present one moment and then gone in an instant, only to be replaced with anger, fear, or uncertainty. In my story, my mother struggled with depression as well as alcoholism. My father was much more stable, but due to his work schedule, he was often an absent character in my daily life. My mother's struggles continued throughout my childhood and beyond. I have always had great compassion for her life story, even as it spilled pain into mine. When she was a young child, both her mother and father passed away. Tuberculosis and pneumonia stole the lives of her parents and left her abandoned in grief. Even though loving relatives adopted her and cared for her, this grief was with her always. She was unable to lay it down, so she learned to carry it with her, hidden from sight, but always present in her heart. Grief would silently direct the acts of her story. I believe that she never recovered from this loss of primary love. When her own children were born, she loved them fiercely, but was never able to emotionally connect with or express her love freely. I know that she loved us deeply, but there were no hugs, kisses, or declarations of love in our home. Her disconnect was too great, a valley of grief that we, as her children, could not cross. From outward appearances, my mother seemed to be a successful mother and wife. Behind the scenes was another story. She played her role well, but was all the while disconnected from the love she so desperately wanted and needed. When depression and anxiety consumed her mind, she consumed alcohol. It was the numbing potion that took the pain and tucked it away at least for a few hours. For her, it became a nightly ritual, much to my father's disapproval, to reward herself with a drink or several before my father arrived home from work. Looking back, I now believe that her depression was so great that she was merely enduring each day, accomplishing her duties as wife and mother so that she could then allow herself to drink at night. Her goal was to become comfortably numb. As the years passed and as she continued to drink more and more, raging alcoholism took hold of her mind, body, and spirit and refused to let go. In the end, it had its way with her. I learned as a young child that, in order to receive love from my mother, I needed to bring love. I also learned my love was not always accepted, much less returned. Instinctively, I knew there was an invisible wall between us, and that this wall could not be crossed over except during certain times and only if permission was given. I did not really understand the rules of this game we were playing, and it made me sad each time I lost. I loved my mother unconditionally, and in my child's heart, forgave her every time I did not receive a hug or kiss when I longed for one. I forgave her every time I witnessed her reach for a drink instead of love. Since my job was to make the best of the story I had been given, instead of complaining, I always tried to be a good and helpful little girl. This was how I earned love and attention. If I cleaned my room without being asked, maybe my brothers too, my mother would always smile and be happy for a while. If she was happy, then she would not want to drink, and all would be well. These were my gifts to my mother. This was how I learned to exchange love with my mother. I relished what love was returned to me, no matter how small or fleeting. For those moments in time, love was mine. I was joyful because I had been rewarded for being a good girl. I had successfully earned my mother's love. I had played the game well, and I had won. As my story continued, I carried this strategy into my adolescent years and continued to make it work for me. It was the 1970s, and I began to create a new reality for my spirit through school, friends, and activities. I was growing into a beautiful young woman, and it was my time to shine. I began to distance myself from my mother's painful, depressing world. I discovered how powerful the love of a boyfriend, or even just a close friend, could be. I also discovered that a driver's license and permission to use a car equaled freedom. What a joy that was, to have the power to release myself from pain and move towards love. I could fly away towards joy and love, and my ticket was earned by pleasing my parents. In the 1970s, it was all about the freedom to choose whatever brought joy, peace, and love. I totally embraced the spirit of that era. It felt good to be carried on that wave of unconditional love and acceptance. I indulged myself in it all, the music, the fashion, the spirit of complete freedom to choose and create what I desired. I also indulged in experimenting with alcohol and drugs, which was the norm in my social group. Private parties and school-sponsored events, such as dances and games, always included alcohol and marijuana. The consumption usually took place in a parked car at the location of the event. Any adult supervision, usually teachers, appeared to turn a blind eye to it all. Perhaps they did not care, or who knows, maybe they were indulging as well. The legal drinking age was 18, and if you could not find someone to purchase it for you, beer and wine could be easily purchased with a false ID. Marijuana could be found without much effort just by walking to the nearest parking lot. There was always someone waiting to share the high. No police or resource officers were present. We, as free spirits, were in control, and it was all such an easy game to play. When I entered high school and was introduced to marijuana, I discovered that this substance had the power to give me the peace and calm that I had never before experienced. It had the power to erase any feelings of anxiety and uncertainty that hovered in my mind. When I smoked marijuana, my world was a happy place. Alcohol made me feel even better. I also began to smoke cigarettes during this time because my first boyfriend smoked. If time permitted between classes, we would meet for a cigarette break. In order to keep the smokers out of the bathrooms, my school provided a designated smoking area behind the main building. It was here that my boyfriend and I came together to feed our nicotine addictions. During my junior and senior years of high school, I chased the high on the weekends and managed to be a fairly decent student during the week. Looking back, I believe that my parents were aware of the drinking but chose not to confront me. At that time, in the 70s, the attitude of many parents was, "We don't approve of drinking, but it's better than doing drugs. Please stay away from the drugs because they are dangerous. They will destroy your life." This was a dangerous compromise, and for me, would have long-lasting consequences. By the time I graduated, I was drinking almost every weekend. I could not wait to get to college where, away from my parents, my choices would all be under my control. I would be free to feed my growing indulgence for alcohol. I would be free to smoke any time I pleased. The seeds of addiction had been planted and were waiting eagerly to be watered. And so the water began to flow. Chapter 2, Freedom and Beyond. The 4-year college I chose to attend did indeed allow me to water my growing addictions. In fact, it allowed me to saturate them. The year was 1975, and the drinking age for beer and wine was still 18. My parents, like many other parents, believed their daughter was safely tucked away for the next 4 years to study and earn a degree. Surely I would not be allowed to indulge in any dangerous or immoral behavior. I was pleasantly surprised to find that, Even in this very traditional all-women's college, the regulations and attitudes toward drinking were very liberal. The dorm mothers that were placed in all freshman dorms served as sentinels to prevent any male visitors from entering past the reception rooms. While the school took a stand on preventing sexual encounters, it took no stand on drinking. Both alcohol and smoking were allowed in all of the dorms. Everyone drank, and the majority of students smoked. Alcohol was present in all school-sponsored events. It wasn't a dance or a party without a keg of beer or some punch made from whatever liquor and wine were available. At these events, alcohol consumption and drinking to excess was the norm, not the exception. On the other hand, illegal drugs were not allowed. Possession of any drugs would result in automatic expulsion. During the next 4 years, I continued the pattern of excessive drinking. I indulged primarily on the weekends so that there was time and a clear mind to focus on my classes during the week. There was too much at stake to do otherwise. I knew that if my grades started to fall and I had to leave college, my world that I had so carefully crafted would come tumbling down. If I was forced to return home, my freedom and my ability to water my seeds would be taken from me. I was determined that, no matter what, that tumbling down was never going to happen. I would do whatever was necessary to protect my world. I would play the game according to their rules. So, a few months into my freshman year, I made the decision to give up marijuana. As I released this drug from my life, I began to fully embrace my love of drinking and smoking. As this love affair began to flourish, alcohol and cigarettes became my best friends. They were always by my side, ready to soothe the anxieties and stress that were common for me during those years. They became my reward for a job well done, and my solace when things did not go well. They brought peace to my mind and body. By the time I graduated from college in 1979, I had earned a degree in psychology and special education. I had also secured my path to alcoholism. As I began to search for a secure place in the world, I carried my best friends with me into my future. After college, I secured a teaching position in special education. I was barely earning enough to support myself, but I never went hungry, nor did I ever go without alcohol or cigarettes. I continued to chase the high on the weekends, but never let it interfere with my teaching responsibilities. I began to master the art of being a functional alcoholic, but was in complete denial of the truth about my life. In 1985, I met my husband, and a year later, we were married. In this new phase of my life, I continued to balance my drinking and my responsibilities. I focused on creating a life that allowed me to drink and still function as a fairly responsible wife, mother, and professional. The only time I stopped drinking completely was during my two pregnancies in 1990 and 1994. My sons were born 4 years apart. Once the pregnancy and nursing were finished, I began to drink again. My children were, and continued to be, my greatest blessing. They were each one a gift from God. They inspired me to focus less on my addictions and more on the love that had been given to me through the grace of God. There were, however, some nagging questions that often entered my mind. Was God still loving me when I chose to continue to drink after having been given such precious gifts? How was that possible? In my way of thinking, all love was earned by being good. The concept of unconditional love and grace did not apply to me. Even though I did carry some shame for drinking and smoking, I convinced myself that I was still a good mother in every other way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.